Hey, what's up, everybody? It's time for JC Youth Online, our online youth groups at Journeys Crossing. I am Scott, if we haven't met. I'm the youth pastor of Journeys Crossing. And if you were with us last week at JC Youth Online, you got to be a part of an amazing conversation about race that we called More Than Skin Deep. And it was about what we as Jesus followers can do to speak into the topic of racism in our world, in our country. And then again on Wednesday nights, we engaged the topic at midweek groups. We talked a bunch with a group of teenagers and adults about how teenagers are impacted by and can be people who help fight against racism, which was so dope and an amazing way to spend some time together. And I think it could be the beginning of some real good in our youth groups. I don't know if you know this, but we live in the most diverse county in America. And our youth group's super diverse, and our church is super diverse. But it doesn't mean that we don't have to deal with racism. And I think that God's got some real work for us to do in leading the way on all that, because diversity has been a value for Journeys Crossing since jump. So we're going to keep paying attention to him and seeing where this conversation goes and how we can speak into it. All right, cool. So for today, big news of the week. You are officially done with school. Congratulations, everybody, especially to our senior class at JC. It has been so hard, and I'm so sorry for how it's all gone down, guys. But without further ado, let's celebrate the JC senior class of 2020.
Seniors, we love you.
Congrats.
Thank you.
Sweet. All right, class of 2020, you guys are amazing. You will be incredibly missed. You already are. And you're incredibly loved, too. Like, our staff, our volunteers at JC Youth want you to know we're here for you. Like, to point you to Jesus, to walk alongside you, and just to be friends to you forever. We're around. An eighth grader is going into ninth grade, and the fifth grader is coming into middle school stuff. Welcome aboard. Welcome to JC Youth. So glad to have you a part of the family. So cool. All right, so the year was 2001, 2002, and our seniors were being born. So let's see what you know about the world they were born into. This is called The Year is 2002. Here's how it's going to work. I'm going to give you questions about 2002. They're going to show up right here. Let's see how many of them you can answer by putting the letter of the answer in the chat right over there. Give you 3 seconds for each question. So, first one, which of the following took place in 2002? A, Kelly Clarkson won the first season of American Idol. B, the first Harry Potter movie was released. C, Apple released the iPod. D, President Clinton got in trouble. Give you 3 seconds. 3, 2, 1. Answer? A, Kelly Clarkson won the first season of American Idol. Cool. All right, second question. See how this works? Disney movie that was released in 2002. It was an A, Toy Story. B, Finding Nemo. C, Monsters, Inc. D, Lilo and Stitch. Give you 3 seconds. 2, 1, Lilo and Stitch. Good job. Okay. Album of the year in 2002. Was it Bye 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 by NSYNC, Come Away With Me, Norah Jones, The Eminem Show by Eminem, or Walk On by Us? Whoever Us is. Not Us, but okay. Anyway. Answer. 3, 2, 1. Come Away With Me, Norah Jones. Great song. I don't know the album, but great song. Fourth, put these 2002 movies in order by the most money made at the box office. So, which of these made the most money down to which one made the least? You got Ice Age, Star Wars Episode II, Attack of the Clones, Bourne Identity, Lord of the Rings, The Two Towers. Put them in the order of the one that made the most money to the one that made the least. Okay? Give you a little more time. 6 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, which one made the most at the box office? It was Lord of the Rings, Two Towers, amazing movie. Then Star Wars Episode II, Attack of the Clones, maybe the worst Star Wars movie of all time. Like, there's debate, but the fight with Yoda was pretty cool. Anyway, Ice Age then, and then rounding out the bottom was The Bourne Identity. So, okay. Next, which didn't happen in 2002? Which of these events did not happen in 2002? So the World Cup was held in South Korea and Japan. Britney Spears and Justin Timberlake broke up. NASA's Mars rover landed on Mars. Yu-Gi-Oh! Launched in the USA, which did not happen in 2002. 3 seconds. 2, 1. NASA's Mars rover didn't land on Mars. That didn't happen in 2002. Okay, next. Average cost of gas in 2002. Some of you guys are driving. So $1.12, $1.36, $1.91, $2.10. What's your answer? 3, 2, 1, $1.36. All right. Next, who was born in 2002? Was it Finn Wolfhard, Billie Eilish, Lil Pump, Willow Smith? Put the letter to your answer in the chat. 3, 2, 1, Finn Wolfhard. Good job. All right. Next, what was the average cost of a movie ticket in 2002? $4.53, $5.81, $6.45, $7.24. The answer, 3, 2, 1, $5.81. Good job. All right, Super Bowl 2002. Who won it? Seattle, Detroit, New York, New England. Who won it? Yeah, the Pats. All right, 3, 2, 1, the Pats. It was the Pats. Okay. Best movie of 2002. Who won the Academy Award for Best Movie? Was it Traffic, The Pianist, Lord of the Rings, Two Towers, Chicago? 3, 2, 1, Chicago. Yep, good job. Okay, and a tiebreaker. Not that we need a tiebreaker, but tiebreaker. What were the most popular baby names in 2002? Was it Jacob, Grace, David, Madison, Tyler, Hannah, Michael, Emily? Which two? Which was the guy's name? What was the girl's name? 3, 2, 1. Write the names in. 3, 2, 1. Jacob and Emily. Good job. All right, so how many of those did you know? Some of them were easy, and others you just had no clue, right? I mean, that was almost 20 years ago. You weren't even alive. But it is a good illustration of what life is like sometimes. Like, sometimes our questions in life, they're really easy. Like, really easy to answer, clear-cut questions. And sometimes, other times, we've just got no clue how to answer our questions. And that's especially true when you're trying to figure out what to do next in life. Like, sometimes the paths that we take, they're really clear, like easy to go, oh, that's a really great decision. But other times, we're unsure of what to do. And that can get really tricky if you're trying to figure out what God might have to say about any of that. Like, is he trying to lead you? And how would he even do that? Our doubts and our questions sometimes leave us feeling lost or confused. Like we wish we had a sign from God to point us in the right direction. Like, don't you sometimes wish that God would just go that way, make that choice? This whole series, we've been talking about doubts and questions about God. And this week we're wrapping up our conversation by talking about how you figure out what God might want you to do. And especially for you seniors right now, like, this is a real thing. Who knows exactly what the future is going to look like? With COVID in the middle of everything, we're all in limbo trying to figure out what's next. I just think it would be awesome if we could just peek into the future 6 months just to see what the world is going to look like. Like, if you're planning on going to college, to know whether or not your school's going to be open, or if you've got a gap year, what your job might look like, or what you might enjoy doing, or what the job market's going to look like in 6 months. Wouldn't it be cool to be able to see, like, the future? And what about even farther out, like 7 years from now? Like, what kind of job you're going to have getting out of school? Or maybe where you'll be working in 10 years? Or will you be married? Will you have kids? Like, that's crazy to think about. But in 7 years, you might know the answers to some of those questions. And who knows what those are going to look like? What about further out, like 25 years or 40 or 50 years? Like, what does it look like for you to be retired? That's a crazy thought. And listen, we might not have thought about our hopes or goals for those kinds of questions, but even before all this craziness, the directions that our lives go in, they're largely unknown to us. And that can be really scary. Because what if you make, like, the wrong decision? And how do you figure out what the right decision looks like, or where God might want you to go, or how he might be leading you? Sometimes life feels like a series of decisions that you've got to make that are just scary. And today we're going to look at some people who had questions about that very thing, where God was leading them and how they were going to figure that out, and maybe what they did about it. And we're going to start with me. So back in the day when I was graduating high school, which, yes, I admit it was 1,000 years ago, but when I was right in the middle of deciding what I wanted to do in my life, I had some major choices to make. See, I started in a relationship with Jesus when I was, like, really young. I was baptized at 9, I think. And I didn't really get at the time that Jesus and I, that our friendship really needed to impact my everyday life, like that it really could. And I didn't really get that until 11th grade. But by that point, I was into the party scene. And I had my group of friends, and we were tight. But when I was around them, and I think this was more about me than it was them, I did things that I really wasn't proud of to feel like I was more accepted. I don't think I was actually any more accepted, because I already was accepted. They were my friends. But that's what I did. I got tricked into thinking something was true that really wasn't. And I didn't know how to get out of it. And to be honest, I felt like if I went to a regular university, I wouldn't make good choices. And I really wanted to pursue my relationship with God and kind of get to know him better, build a foundation, and get more secure in our friendship. So when it came to college, I was either going to go to this really great school that had a good psychology program, or I was going to spend a year at a Christian college and get some Bible stuff under my belt and, like, figure out a relationship with Jesus, what it looked like. And you know, it really wasn't easy to determine which path I should take. Like, I really wanted God to just kind of make it clear. Like, I wanted him to just say, do this. Choose this school. This is the where I want you to be. But God was kind of quiet about the whole thing. He really wasn't answering my questions. And while the decision I had to make was difficult, people have been making really hard decisions in the world forever. And it's really nothing compared to those. Like once, a lady had to make a decision that would either cost her life or not, and the end result of which could have meant genocide would be committed against her people. And her name was Esther, and Esther's got her own book in the New Testament, meaning that God thought her story of making a decision was important enough to record. So before we start into the story of Esther, here's what you need to know.
The Book of Esther, it's one of the more exciting and curious books in the Bible. The story is set over 100 years after the Babylonian exile of the Israelites from their land. And while some Jews did return to Jerusalem, remember Ezra and Nehemiah, many did not. And so the Book of Esther is about a Jewish community living in Susa, the capital city of the ancient Persian Empire. And the main characters in this story are two Jews, Mordecai, and then his niece Esther. And then there's the king of Persia, who's something of a drunken pushover in this story. And then there's the Persian official Haman, the cunning villain. Now, this is a curious book in the Bible, mainly for the fact that God is never even mentioned, not once, which might strike you as kind of odd. I mean, isn't the Bible about God? But this is a brilliant technique by the author, who's anonymous, by the way. It's an invitation to read this story looking for God's activity, and there are signs of it everywhere. The story is full of very odd, quote, coincidences and ironic reversals, and it all forces you to see God's purpose at work, but behind the scenes.
All right, so you've got all the players. There's this king, Xerxes of Persia, doesn't follow God, but there are a lot of Jewish people in his kingdom who he had as prisoners who did. Now, one day, Xerxes gets drunk and angry at his wife, Queen Vashti, because she refuses to parade herself in front of a bunch of his ruler buddies who he wants to impress, and Xerxes throws Vashti out of the palace and begins the search for a new wife. How they treated women was ridiculous. So he was determined to find the most beautiful girl in all of Persia to be his new queen, whether the girl was down for that or not. And here's Esther, and she's beautiful, she's smart, she's brave. A Jewish girl, she hides that fact, displaced in this country, and throughout the first four chapters of the Book of Esther, she becomes the queen. The new queen replaces Vashti. And there are beauty pageants and murder plots, and it's actually a really great read. So we've got Esther in this position of power. Now, the video talked about the bad guy in the story, a guy named Haman. And Haman puts into action this plan to kill all of the Jewish people. We're talking genocide here. And all because Esther's uncle, Mordecai, a Jewish man, refuses to bow down to Haman. And here's Esther in this place of power with a chance to make a difference and to save her people. The problem is if you go in to see the king without an appointment, they kill you. Walk-ins are not welcome. So Mordecai counsels Esther and helps her make a really hard choice, knowing that her life hangs in the balance, like her life is on the line. And in a time of uncertainty, Esther's choice saves the life of all of God's people. Now, even though, like the video said, God's not mentioned in the Book of Esther, like at all, in the whole book, I'm sure Esther talked to God a bunch about what to do. I'm guessing that that was her practice. But I do know for sure that she talked to her uncle Mordecai, a godly voice, a godly person in her life. And that is important. Now, we're going to talk about one more person in the Bible. Let's take a look at one of the greatest prophets of all scripture, a man named Elijah.
introduce the role of the prophets, key figures in Israel's history. So in the Bible, prophets were not fortune tellers. Rather, they spoke on behalf of the God of Israel, and they played the role of covenant watchdogs, which means they called out idolatry and injustice among the kings and the people. They were constantly reminding Israel of their calling to be a light to the nations, that they should obey the commands of the Torah, and so the prophets challenged Israel to repent and follow their God. In these center sections for each king, God then raises up prophets to hold them accountable. And the most prominent prophets are the northern ones, Elijah and his disciple Elisha, right here in the center of the book. Elijah was a wild man of a prophet living out in the desert, and his arch nemesis was the northern king Ahab and his Canaanite wife Jezebel. Together, these two had instituted the worship of the Canaanite god Baal over Israel. And so in a famous story, Elijah challenged 450 prophets of Baal to a contest to see which god was real. So they both build altars and pray to their gods, but only the God of Israel answers with fire.
So that episode from Elijah's life with the prophets of Baal from the video and the fire from heaven to show how powerful God was, that had just happened. But right after it happened, Elijah's life gets threatened by Queen Jezebel, also in the video. And Elijah panics, runs away, and he hides in a cave. And in 1 Kings 19, verses 15 through 18, God speaks to him out loud, and here's what he says. The Lord said to him, "Go back the way you came and go to the desert of Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael king over Aram. Also anoint Jehu son of Nimshi king over Israel, and anoint Elisha son of Shaphat from Abel-Meholah to succeed you as prophet. Jehu will put to death any who escape the sword of Hazael, and Elisha will put to death any who escape the sword of Jehu. Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed down to Baal and whose mouths have not kissed him." Okay, so God's instructions to Elijah here might seem a little odd, like maybe irrelevant, boring, and maybe that's the way that it looks at first glance, but they're actually really important instructions. God tells Elijah to get connected with this group of people, like a support system, a group of people who can help him. God knew Elijah needed other godly people in his life to help him do what he needed to do. And even though he had comforted Elijah directly, he was still like, get connected to these people. They'll help you to finish strong. Now, when we're experiencing confusion or fear or uncertainty, it's super easy to question God and say, "Hey, I'm trying to do this for you. So just be clear. Like, why are you making this hard? Why are you allowing this to be hard? Why aren't you showing me what I'm supposed to do next, making my path clear?" That's a really easy thing to say. But scripture never really promises that God will directly tell you what your next steps are supposed to be exactly. So maybe instead of peeking into the future, maybe we need to start getting better at looking into the past. Like Esther and Elijah's stories show us that God puts godly people in our lives to help us figure things out, to give us the godly advice that we need to make a good decision. So, how do we make decisions when we're not sure what God wants us to do next? Well, part of that is getting a support system. And it's because of today's big idea, and it's this. Godly people can help us with our questions. So when I had to make my decision about where to go to school, God brought my friend Paul into the story. Now, Paul was an intern at my church, and he saw right through the games that I was playing with God, the whole double life thing that I was doing. And he challenged me to put my relationship with God first, where it belonged. You know what? Deciding to go to a Bible college for a year became one of the pivotal decisions of my life. Like 1 year turned into 4 years, and 4 years turned into a degree. And it helped me to find my passion for helping teens who were being tricked in middle school and high school like I was. Like God was saying to me, "Scott, you understand what it's like to be tricked in middle school and high school into playing all the popularity games and doing all the weird stuff that happens." And I was like, "Yeah, I probably could help with that. I'll do that for the rest of my life if you let me." I was introduced to my wife and friends of mine that are some of the best in my life. And I met the dude who 15 years later would come and talk to me about becoming the youth pastor at this really cool church in Maryland called Journeys Crossing. What a huge decision. And what a great decision. So if you're watching this, Paul, I owe you, buddy. Thank you for being a godly voice in my life. And hopefully I've gotten to do that for others like you've done for me. Back in 2002, there was this game show going. It was called Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? Do you remember this show? Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? You could win $1 million just by answering increasingly harder trivia questions. And when a contestant got stuck on a trivia question, they could do what's called phone a friend. You remember this? Phone a friend? They could ask one person that they trusted for advice. Now, those contestants probably had a few different categories of people on their phone a friend list. Like, they probably had a history buff or a science guy, a pop culture person, or a sports fan. So I want us to think for a minute about the different kinds of categories of people that we might want as our phone a friends, but just in life. Like, here, do this. Try this. Get a piece of paper, and we're gonna write down the following words. Now, don't worry, the words are gonna be on the screen, but take a second and do this because it's super crazy helpful. Okay, so let's try this. Go get a piece of paper and a pen, and you're gonna write down the following words. Ready? Here are the words. Cheerleader, counselor, coach, mentor, pastor, confidant, prayer support. All right, you got it? Okay, write those down. And as you do, we're gonna think for a minute, maybe pray for a minute, to think about people in your life to fill those roles for you. In fact, let's do that right now. Like, let's talk about that. Cheerleader. When you need a dose of encouragement and positivity, who's your go-to person? Who do you always trust to give you a pep talk that's full of godly truth? What about a counselor? Somebody who always gives you godly advice, like scripture-based, you're in a dilemma, you've got questions, you don't know how to move forward. Who do you trust to help you take a good next step? Or coach. Who motivates you to keep making progress on the goals you've got with God? Or what about a mentor? Someone who's kind of older than you, who's got an ongoing relationship with you and with God, who makes you better, and maybe you trust enough to share some details of your life with. A lot of your youth workers at Journeys Crossing are in this category. Or a pastor. What about a pastor? Like somebody who's got, maybe has the official title of pastor or maybe doesn't. But somebody who's guiding you and advising you in your relationship with God, who's got a good relationship with God themselves, and is helping you develop yours. Or what about a confidant? Who's your go-to person to talk about your deepest, darkest stuff? Somebody who's really safe and trusted and godly wise. Who's your confidant? And then lastly, prayer support. This could be one person or a group of people who you can always trust to pray for you. I've got a group of friends that prays for me every single week, and so should you, and you do if you're a student out there. Our youth workers are always praying for our students. All right, so here are the questions. Who'd you choose for each category? Do they know that that's their role in your life? Have you thanked them for it? And why them? Why'd you choose them and not others? So these people aren't going to guarantee that you'll always make right decisions when you're uncertain about which way to go and how God's leading you, but at least they'll help make good decisions easier to make. And that's really helpful. All right, so the whole point of this series has been to help you let God make you not afraid or help you not be afraid of your questions. And we've covered a lot of things in this series, like how having doubts and questions is normal because you're not alone in your questions. And how God doesn't shame us for our questions, but helps us find evidence that we need in order to believe. And then especially when life gets painful and disappointing things happen, we know that our questions don't always get answered like we want. But God's with us in the middle of all of them. And then like we learned today, when we're questioning or doubting which way to go or maybe where God is leading us, God knows and can bring godly people into our lives to help us with our questions. Gives us a support system to help us. His church, our youth group, your youth workers, your parents, tons of people to help you. You know, as we close out this series, I hope that the main things you take away are, one, that you don't have to be afraid of your doubts and your questions, because God can handle them and we can walk alongside you as you deal with them. And I hope that you feel in our group safe enough to voice your questions and doubts whenever you need to, at least with one person in our youth group, in our youth ministry. And when you have that question or doubt that you need to process, I hope you know that we love you and are always here for you. That's what we're here for. We want to walk you through those things and help you to come on the other side, trusting God more and more.
This is for all the graduating seniors who couldn't walk the stage. I know it truly must suck to not walk the stage. And all the time you've created all these meaningful friendships just cut short. Even in times like this, in times that everything seems to go wrong in the midst of a global pandemic, just know you are on to the next adventure. In a while, this will just be another chapter in a beautiful book written by you. You got this.
Awesome. All right. Hey, thank you guys so much for hanging out with us today at JC Youth Online. To the class of 2020, to our 8th grade coming in class, our 5th grade coming in class, congratulations all of you. To our coming in classes, we're so excited to have you in youth ministry. Welcome. And for those of you who are graduating, heading off to college or a gap year or doing whatever you're doing, we love you guys so much, class of 2020. Hey, all of you, the next adventure with God is right around the corner. So cool. All right, so if you've got a friend that wants to come and check out what we're doing at JC Youth Online, you can have them check out our replay today at 5 o'clock on our youth ministry Insta page, Journeys Crossing YM. You can have them check us out there. You can pause this video right now and get all of our contact information, our call, email, text stuff, our information, website, ilovethischurch.com/youth, our Sunday morning e-news, comes out every Sunday morning at 7 a.m. on social media. You can find us on Insta, Facebook, and Twitter. That's updated all the time, so check that out. Stay connected daily if you want, please, by checking us out on Insta every day at noon. We've got a daily prayer time, really, really short. Pray along with me. Check us out there every single day on Instagram. Now, for tonight, we've got no debriefing groups, but next Sunday, June 21st, we do have debriefing groups. And for you youth workers out there, you adult youth workers, We've got our youth team meeting, our monthly or bi-weekly youth team meeting. So check that out at 7 o'clock. The Zoom link will be in the description below. Okay? All right. Now, coming up soon, we were going to try to have all of our summer dates out to you today. We couldn't make that happen because we are planning for Mix and Move Conference, but we're going to be doing them very, very differently than we ever have before. So check that out. Information should be on its way for next week. Got some dates to coordinate and stuff. All right. Thank you guys so much for checking us out at JC Youth Online today. We miss you guys. We love you. We are out. Later on, guys. Bye.